Last week was just nice because last week was our first initial program, started off last week, but this was the pinnacle because today is the national day itself. So that is one of the reason why we have like a soft launch last week, and this week is the official day where we start off our program. Last week we start off, but last week we don't have the booklet. So this is going to be a monthly event. Hopefully that monthly event. So we are really hope that if the celebration and the acceptance by the public is good, then we're gonna repeat it. I'm not sure once a month or twice a month, I'm not sure yet. But depending on the request by the first from PNB itself and also from the public. So I think when you see the crowd, we are very happy because at the end of the day, we know that they are not talking by all time. Alright,
everyone got
their booklet. So, hari ni saya akan take sikit je sebab ada bising. So, some of the, if you notice on the booklet, some of the chat pun aku combine. Because of the event that is happening at the stadium right now, I will combine some of the chat point. So that it will be much more pleasant for you to know and enjoy yourself about the stadium. And I don't want to say that you must hear to what I'm talking about all the time. I'm not here to make a mess of your ears. I'm just here to escort you. I'm just escorting you guys to enjoy the feeling of reliving being a part of Malaysian. How to be a Malaysian during the early days, being a modern nation, a free nation. Alright? Give a very big clap for yourself because spending your time for 60 minutes of your time to listen to a little bit of my celote. I will not say we are not here to listen to a history class. Remember, it's not a history class. This is not something very formal. It's not a class in whatever form. It's a time, a space for you to hang around your family, hang around your friends, hang around with your whoever that you know from here, from today, to enjoy yourself, to understand the feeling. And orang kata apa, evoke a bit of your memories, treat a little bit of your heart and mind to understand what is actually being a Malaysian is all about. Okay? Being a Malaysian is very easy to say, isn't it? But how many people really understood what is Malaysian? What is Malaysia? Apa itu Malaysia? Apa itu Merdeka, for example? Apa itu Melayu? There's always a difference. And when we talk about all these sort of things, there's always key item we mentioned. Nama dia warisan. Waris itu, there's something that relate between one thing from the past that can be sustained by the present to be passed to the future. That is warisan. Dia kena ada pergerakan. They must have a movement. Either from the past, the present and the future. That was the reason. Okay? And in that case, I would like to share with you today. And my name is Afzal Azhari. I will be guiding you, and looking after you for the benefit of the country. Cheer. For these 60 minutes, making sure that Malaysia will become prosperous, I have to make sure of my 20 nice population of Malaysia to be still with me, and later on to have a much more, what we call, much more spiritual feeling of being part of Malaysia. So today's trip, it will consist the whole stadium, but don't worry, we are not an athlete, we are disabled. Partly disabled because, like me, I have a stomach which is not good for me to walk too fast. Alright? So we are talking our own sweet time. Don't worry about whether you are leaving behind. There's always my friends around here that will look after you guys. Don't worry, they will always guide you. If you anyone who wants to go to the toilet is at this building. If you want to go somewhere else, it's not permitted because you might get lost. That's our concern. Okay? Because, as you can see now, it's still a construction site. Part of the area is also a construction site. So we must be careful about it. Alright, then first and foremost, we're going to go up to the foyer, very quickly, look at just a bit of the whole, whatever happened at the stadium at the moment. Then we'll go down straight to the grandstand, and very briefly as well because of the warm weather, very typical Malaysian, touch the grass and move away. Okay. Don't run because you will snap your energy. Walk, jaywalking to the south side, south terrace. Then you go to the south terrace, you go for the vantage point of the stadium and also the tower as a whole. And then we'll move to the VI terrace, to the scoreboard. See what is so big about the scoreboard altogether. And then turn another 200 meters being a Usain Bolt. But in my case, cannot be Usain Bolt. Usain lambat. Ataupun Usain kat limah. So we back to the main area, then we will meet up somewhere around that door because I think it's going to be very very warm. So because of we have kids nowadays, adik-adik jangan takut. Kalau tak faham, tak kira, angkat aja. Angkat, tak faham. Kaki apa pun kira, tapi itu apa kita punya Stadium Merdeka ni is a very unique place. Sebab nama dia tak Stadium Negara, dia panggil Merdeka. All the new building during the early days of independence, this is the only part that we call Merdeka. Very very unique, if you notice. But I cannot tell you too much because of the noise is going to overwhelm all my talking. So, and also the warmth, we're going to go up very very quickly, or maybe we straight go to the grandstand. Maybe later we will spend time more on the foyer. So we straight go to the grandstand. Don't worry about stepping later on. Don't worry.
For the answer of the book.
Alright, everybody here? The less crowd lah. Just now it's much more crowded than
that.
So to be clear, because of they're going to do their training of their drumming. So basically, as the foyer has mentioned just now, Stadium Merdeka is the first. It's the first from all the new buildings as a modern player. If you notice about all the buildings, Bangsa Sri Sabah does not resemble at all how modern Melayu is a progressive nation. So, this was completed, officiated on the 30th August 1957. One day before the proclamation of the independence. One day before. Through the spirit of Melayu, being a Malaysian, we always punching about our way, we got two more records. At this place that you're sitting right now, we're standing right now, in 1957, 31st August, this was the largest cantilever shell roof in the world during that time. This 19-roof shell roof, they call it, that was the largest in the world during that time, 1957. But this is not the only one, there's two. Another one is the flood situation, how it was constructed is different. And it was pre-stressed, it was constructed in situ. So very, very unique. So the early days of the modern nation, first day, dari dua rekod dunia. Ramai lah, saya memang bawa, belum apa-apa lagi dua pinggang emas. Dua pinggang emas, typical nation. Very typical nation because of, if you notice, at the first beforehand. It become a world record because of necessity. Why? Because of the condition. They want to do the construction fast. So pre-stress in situ will be faster. They don't fabricate outside. They do it in situ. So they move very fast.
I can spend more time, but I don't want it to be in the hot sun. So I prefer you to go and
sikit je lah, problem sikit, dia bising sikit lah. Alright. So basically after I mentioned just now about Tunku just now, he was the key person that ensured that this building was built. So I always mention Tunku is the founder of this Stadium Merdeka. Alright. We have the founder, we have the revival. Revival later on we'll talk about it. Alright. But the founder will always be Tunku. Tunku was very visionary. When he decided that we have to have our independence, he always feel that to have independence, it cannot be only it is a symbolism. Symbolism in the form of physical infrastructure, physical building. So, when looking upon all the buildings, Stadium Merdeka falls under priority number one. If you imagine as a modern nation, normally we will talk about what? Any palace, parliament, so that, maybe about the municipal hall, town hall, related to governance. But from Tengku point of view, no. Being a Malaysia, being a Malaya during that time, as a free country, we have to be for everybody, regardless of your race, regardless of your religion, regardless of your status, regardless of everything that you have perceived before this. At this point of time, we are the same. Everybody is the same. Nobody is different. Even Tunku himself, which is a royal blood, he's the brother of the Sultan of Kedah. At what point of time, he also feel that I must be part of the public population, the mass. So I must find a place that is accessible to everybody, regardless of where they are. And so, after scouting around, Stadium Merdeka was chosen at this particular location. And who was the architect? That was Stanley Jukes. Stanley Jukes is American born, naturalized as a Briton, as a British. He was during at that point of time, he was not trained as an architect in the beginning. He was actually a civil engineer. That's why he are able to design all this engineering marvel, because he was partly engineer, also partly architect. So he understand about the aesthetic part, he also understand on the structure part. So he's able to talk about both sides lah. So that is very advantage to Stanley Jukes, right? Stanley Jukes able to capture whatever that is envisioned by Tunku Rahman, that he transferred to this particular building. And because of the constraint of the time, they were very, very cautious about how it must be constructed. How can we complete it within that year? Because remember, it's less than a year. Less than a year to construct the biggest day of the modern country. Proclamation of independence. There's no way that that day is no bigger than any other day in modern Malaysia. That was the day. So you imagine the pressure. Imagine the pressure. So Stanley Jukes managed to march from his way to be able to galvanize all his experts, intellectual, not just from the foreigners, not from the locals, but also the locals. There's a lot of locals that was also involved in this construction. If you go to the archive of JKR, you will see a lot of these documents. That was also, the team was also partly part of the locals as well, because they were training them. Our early days, kita dah ada rancangan Melaya tu. The 5 years economic plan has already been done at the early days of our independence. During that time, most of the countries that get independent never had the economic plan. We have it. And one of the things that we gain from our loan bank from World Bank is to improve our irrigation. Why? Food security. That's why you got IADA, AIDA kan? AIDA Rompin, AIDA Barat Laut, Kadar, Mada, all sort of thing, because the first round for being a sovereign country is to be able to feed yourself. Agriculture, right? So all other countries, they always forgot about this part. And then we evolved having Belda, Belgra, and also. So that is how it's a evolution, right? So very quickly, we want to fail being a Tunku, sebab air rasa dia terlalu padat. So we going to keep very, very quick on the field. So come to the law.
Macam ni lah anak ayah. Ha?
last week juga ada team Sina FM, dia main bola. So it's not something which is restricted to a lot of people. It can be booked. Cuma you kena queue lah kalau nak pakai padang. Alright. So itu semua yang track ni memang boleh pakai. Don't worry about it. So the idea was because to integrate the whole complex of the stadium ni together with Stadium Negara, which is under conservation work right now. Dia belum siap lagi. So once the Stadium Negara will completed, then we have both lah. Then you can use your, you want to play indoor games also, then you can also book for them. Boleh, correct. Betul. Petang-petang dah boleh pakai. Pagi boleh pakai. Hari Sabtu memang sekarang ni sebab tu dia ada buat macam exercise, zumba dengan yoga session pagi-pagi kan. Sebab dia nak bagi tahu public lah. Nak marketkan tu public ni. Semua dah boleh datang. It's open for all. He didn't say yes physically, the story that was told. He was just saying nothing. He was silent. When Tuan Ahmad Saji, the late Tuan Ahmad Saji says, Dr. Sri, is it possible if we take over this particular stadium? It was the answer was a silent. Which, knowing him for some time, from Tuan Ahmad Saji experience, he said that is a yes. But he has to move quickly. So he decided, through Badan Warisan Malaysia, to make a very very fast paperwork to establish what they call as the Merdeka Ventures, the Merdeka Trust. So the Merdeka Trust was actually the foundation that started off the effort to conserve and protect this building. Because if not, we are not standing in this building anymore. It might be another shopping mall. Honestly speaking, we might have another shopping mall at this point of time. You might be in Uniqlo now. I might having Bukus Kau-Kau right now. Which is very common in any shopping mall in Malaysia. Alright, that's the story.
Actually, bila tahun berapa PNB ambil alihnya?
It was around 2001, 2002. Just after after the Commonwealth Games. After the Commonwealth Games. Then, when the safe grace was actually because of the economic recession. Because of the economic recession, somehow they stopped off this particular project to kick off. So there were no pressure from any of the investors during that time. So Tuan Ahmad Saji quickly, by the virtue of having that sort of effort to bring out the team to mobilize and started off all the management, the studies lah, how to protect and prepare the paperwork so that they can take over and do the conservation work. So when the conservation work was done, that's one of the reason why we see there's no apatia anymore. Because one of the key elements in the conservation management plan was to bring back the stadium as it is during 1957. That's why they demolished the apatia. So they try to remove and the electric billboard, electric scoreboard was replaced with the original one, with the timber scoreboard. That was the timber scoreboard. Not definitely not the original 1957 lah. But it's a replication of that. But it follow the same design. Because the design, all the illumination was the perfect condition. It was really there. So that was the part of the story that we put. Can you imagine during that time, 2001 conservation work in Malaysia is very bad. Maybe not true, I would say very, very rare. Because it's very expensive. But somehow Tuan Ahmad Saji, through Badan Warisan Malaysia, he managed to bring about all the professionals. And because of this work, Stadium Merdeka also gained award, merit award by the UNESCO as one of the best conservation for the cultural heritage monument in the world. So this building has two recognition. One as the National Heritage of Malaysia under the National Heritage Act. Another one is the award merit under UNESCO for the cultural heritage building for conservation work. So this was very very significant because it symbolizes that we have the expertise to conserve our own building. That's the key part. So without further ado, let's go.
Sorry,
second.
Tuan Ahmad Saji. Siapa
sebenarnya? Tuan Ahmad Saji. During that time was the Chief Secretary, Ketua Situasi Negara.
Oh, KSN.
Di KSN. Yeah,
tapi dia bukan PNB.
Dia waktu tu selepas dia pencen, dia jadi pengurusi PNB.
Chairman.
That's how he started off, dipakai nama PNB. That's how PNB took over the land. This particular land together with Stadium Negara. And the one that he cannot preserve was actually the Coronation Park lah. They used to call Merdeka Park. Di sini dulu ada Merdeka Park. It was a public park. Kalau siapa budak VI, dia selalu. My father is a former VI ni.
Itu old boy. Chin-Wu.
Chin-Wu ni on the side. So this area was known for as a recreational area or association area. That's why there's a lot of association.
Oh, itu sebenarnya itu ialah park itu.
Say again?
Tempat tapak itu ialah dulu ialah public park kan?
Yes, it's a public park.
Sebab dulu saya sekolah di MBS.
Ah yes, MBS memang tahulah. Semua ni memang is a public park. That's one the reason kenapa stadium Merdeka was here. Because it's easily accessible, it's easily identified by the locals. If you go to Istana Negara, nanti you nak protokol lah, nak pakai kopiah lah, pakai semua jadi takut. Because we have a very, for our Malaysian, we always have protocol. But for stadium, it's open to public. Semua orang boleh maki orang. Tak pandai main bola satu hari, baru 24 tahun main bola, hari tu jadi sepak tak kena. Tiba-tiba semua maki dia on the same day. Malaysia memang, tapi tak jangan makan dalam lah, kan? Kalau hati tak kental, tak boleh jadi Malaysia lah, kan? So, because it's getting warmer, we're going to get have a very fast dash to the tunnel over there. Jangan lari, penat. Siapa kena rapor ni? Em jaga tesen. Dia boleh kerja. Maybe you are Celine Dion of the day, Sudirman, you will enter here, yes? Yes, of course. Ini longkang dia dalam sikit because of to cater for our monsoon season. Careful nanti ya. Come, 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 please. Wah, angka
Ni barulah.
Ha, ni baru sikit, jadi okey sikit daripada sana.
Yalah, betul. Bagus.
Please go to the tunnel. Have a seat. So that is part of the five part of Malaysia is all about. I always tell a lot of people when you talk about, wah, Malaysia orang conference lah. Wah, macam pergi buffet.
Because in UK, in Europe, for example, yeah. when you have all these conference or any symposium, they just give you, the most they give you a sandwich. Kat Malaysia, lawan tender lagi. How siap ada testing period eh? Oh, nak makan apa lagi? Itu baru minum pagi. I have a session where I was having a chat with one particular particular vendor. He was having five orders, different level. Level 9, level 10, level 3, level 4. Semua makanan lain. So very tough for him, but I mean, they make money outside of one particular building alone. So that was the idea of Malaysia is all about. I mean, when we enter just now, we talk about the independent, right? We move forward from, we talk about just now about how Tun Ahmad Saji become the revival of Stadium Merdeka. Remember, I mentioned about Stadium Merdeka, what the significant part of Stadium Merdeka. When we talk about heritage is not something, it's about old. Kita tak bercakap, bila sebut heritage, dia memang ada perkataan dinamik. Dia akan menceritakan tentang masa lepas. Tetapi not necessary must be 100 years, 50 years, 20 tahun. It can be semalam pun boleh jadi warisan. For example, saya beli nasi lemak semalam. Saya makan dekat nasi lemak Wanjuk, saya beli pukul 9 malam. Saya wariskan kepada anak saya pada pagi hari. Adakah itu menjadi nasi lemak warisan? Sebab perkataan warisan is always been misused. Either lama, vintage, tua, buruk. Apa lagi? Perkataan itu boleh berubah. Antik, correct. Antik, value naik. Buruk, harga dia turun. Usang, harga dia turun. So how we define? Ada setengah bangunan, dia tak cantik. Tapi dia ada nilai sejarah. Dia ada nilai kat situ. Contoh, ada bangsal buruk kat depan tu. Tapi dekat bangsal buruk tu, Tunku Abdul Rahman pernah duduk kat situ. Dia tulis, contohlah kita pun cerita, dia tulis lirik lagu negara tu. Dia tulis lirik dengan tu. Nampak tak? Human behavior, body language. Kita tujuh itu semua final. That's how we make story. That's why as a human being, we are very fortunate because we are not like robots. I always tell a lot of my students as well, remember, jangan jadi terlalu pada AI, artificial intelligence, sampai you lupa nak jadi AI, natural intelligence. Because natural intelligence is us. How we define as a human being is our ability to maintain our natural intelligence, our ability to be focused, our ability to have a target. Because human being, that's why our eyes is facing front, because we always have a target, we have always an objective. We are not the one that is being chased, we are the one that is chasing things. It's a different thing. When you talk about heritage, it's also same as a sustainable, because heritage is inheriting from the past, for the present, to be able to bring forward for the future as well. So kita punya role sekarang ni, saya punya role dan role kita semua ni adalah membawa cerita ni, bukan untuk cerita hari ini saja. Cerita ni akan sampai 50 tahun akan datang. 100 tahun akan dapat, cerita ni akan tak sampai. Sebab diwarisi. Macam mana dia ceritakan, itu terpulang kepada kreativiti masing-masing. Sebab kita bukan history, kita bukan simpan barang antik. Barang antik as is. Warisan can be evolved. You can be creative on how you want to inherit it. This watch might be significant for you as a local heritage. Saya punya jam hanya bernilai kepada anak saya saja. Tidak mungkin bernilai kepada anak orang lain. Tetapi bila jam saya dipakai oleh tuanku yang Duli Yang Maha Mulia sebelum bertindakku, now the value become national heritage. Dia tak jadi dah local heritage. You know, understand? So itulah warisan. So warisan bukan barang lama, bukan cerita lama semata-mata. Alright? Warisan adalah satu benda yang bernilai, yang mempunyai signifikan kepada kita, yang mempunyai ada perasaan di dalam benda itu. Itulah warisan. So bila kita ada warisan tu, kita ada emotional attachment pada situ. So sekarang saya harap kita semua dah rasa, wah, ini berkobar-kobar ni. Kalau suruh nyanyi lagu negara aku sekarang juga boleh juga. So itu kita nakkan, the spirit is like that. When we ask, kita buat social experience, pasang lagu negara aku dekat shopping mall, can everybody raise up their feet, stand tall, betul-betul nyanyikan lagu negara aku. Berapa orang yang hafal lagu negara aku, for example? But I'm going to test you all.
Boleh, makcik.
Makcik nak tangan saya siap. Tapi saya nak tahu nanti, lagi 10, lagi 20 minit sampai ke tapak yang saya nak tahu tu, saya nak tengok berapa orang boleh jawab saya punya soalan nanti. Tapi jangan takut. Soalan tu soalan dah open book. Cuma nak tahu siapa yang betul-betul faham. Being a Malaysian for the past dengan sekarang ni, apa beza ni? Alright? So, sekarang ni kita membayangkan kita Michael Jackson, sebab Michael Jackson keluar daripada software.
Oh.
Sebab dia punya entry point daripada sini, dia nak enter masuk the stadium during the starting day. So that's how it started off. So sekarang ni semua banyak lalu sini. Sheila Majid, whatever you want lah. Sheila Majid, Sheila Dion, Michael Jackson, Backstreet Boys.
Avril Lavigne.
Oh, Avril Lavigne. Sempat ke Avril Lavigne? Sempat ke Avril Lavigne? Ini dia punya age group, kita nak tengok age group ni saya. Dia tadi dah
berita Avril Lavigne
ni, 20 years back ni. Okay, come.
They use this one.
Alamak, lawa lah baju akak. Baju merah punya dah lambang bunga raya tu.
Kita tengok pada Putera Jaya ni.
Putera Jaya?
Ya.
Yeah. Oh, apa-apa.
Datang sini.
Bagusnya, saya terharu lah.
Dari Putera Jaya pagi tadi, main sini.
Boleh dapat bonus lah saya lepas ni.
Kam. Boleh? Tadi best ke kat sana? Oh, pakcik tak boleh pergi lah. Ha? Yes, correct. This was the original. Sebab Dina cepat kan? Sebab Dina kosan cepat, so kita buat semua atas, on the slope. Itu jadi very fast tu. You become very fast. Alright, so this is the tunnel, the main tunnel, the only tunnel that has vehicle access. So, if you know about the FRU, football game, the FRU datang kan? Dia most of the time, dia will come from here.
Yeah, betul.
Medical assistant pun sampai dari sini lah. Betul. Ambulance semua akan datang dari sini. That's the only door. So, this is my connection lah. Tapi lepas ni, kita akan jumpa dia. Ada.
Dia.
Dekat kerja muka. Memang apa dia? Yang asal betul. Sebab waktu salah satu syarat bila kita nak ambil balik stand sikap waktu tu, CNBO tu, dia kena buat satu paperwork, satu kertas kajian. Macam mana dia nak, apa signifikan dia nak ambil. Sebab waktu tu semua orang berkumpul kat sini ni. So waktu tu, berapa sajilah Abang Yahamnya, dia yang berjaya convincekan kan dia tu.
Dia nak robohkan tempat
panas balik. Memang dah emak sepatu dia mesti jadi siap. Sebab dia swapping dengan
kat sana.
Besok ni dia. Semualah hari. Banyak orang datang. Interesting ah. Masa merdeka kan. Oh, dah merdeka kat sini. Kalau dah buang macam mana lagi kita tak ada lagi dah. Kalau maintain boleh ya, kalau buat tenuman bola untuk sekolah ke
ni dia best view lah. Kalau datang pagi sikit boleh ambil gambar kat sini lah. Sekarang pun boleh tapi panas sikit lah. Kita boleh ambil gambar kejap lagi. Very very briefly. So basically this part of the stadium ni, dia one thing of kita selalu forget. Dia punya location tu is very very strategic. Because of, macam I mentioned just now, waktu zaman 1957, this area is actually outskirt. Dia bukan city centre. The town centre is actually in Dataran Merdeka. Masa bangunan ni siap, imagine one year siap bangunan ni, less than one year. Officiated on the 30th August, 30 August dirasmikan. Malam tu pergi Dataran Merdeka. Nak turunkan apa ni? Nak turunkan tu. Besok tu datang balik. Pagi, less than 34 hours. Ada tiga besar event yang paling besar. Officiated of the stadium, lowering down of the Union Jack, and then proclamation of the independence itself on the 31st August. And the 31st August tu, if I'm not mistaken, it was a rainy day. Dia hujan gerimis kejap. Nanti pukul 2 nanti kalau you have the time to meet up dengan Datuk Hajidah, he will be able to share the experience of he was the one of the witness during that proclamation day. He was here masa dia pergi siaran kemerdekaan. So macam saya cakap tadi, one of the thing, the unique part of the stadium, it was designed by Stanley Jukes. Stanley Jukes was actually during that time was the director of PWD ataupun sekarang ni kita panggil Ketua Pengarah JKR lah. Okay, Stanley Jukes was trained as a civil, as engineer, but he also trained as an architect as well. So he has two expert. He also can be able to do engineering, he also can able to do design. So when, because of that ability, that's one reason why for this stadium there's two engineering marvel. I think the early stage I mentioned about two things. There's two world record. By the day of 31st August 1957, Stadium Merdeka boosted two world records in the same time. One is the largest cantilever roof shelf yang you nampak ada 19 tu, ulang-ulang. You tengok dalam stadium ni, ni logo dia lah. Cantilever shelf roof, ni the shelf roof. Okay? Yang macam tu. It's very very
tengah
popular.
Tengah-tengah tu tiang bendera.
Macam mana?
Tengah-tengah dulu petiang bendera.
Betul. Dulu tengah tiang bendera, betul. Sebab, tapi selalu ramai orang tak perasan. Dalam gambar tak apa-apa nak nampak. Sebab dia view dia tak apa-apa clear kan. Tapi share room tu memang very popular during that time. Tapi sebab dia was the largest one in the whole world in 1957 during that day. Another part is this flatline itself. This flatline was actually the tallest in the world during that time. Pre-stress, pre-stress flatline. The tallest pre-stress flatline tower in the world, 1957. To give you a context, to give you a context, compared to PNB 118, ini 16 kali duduk atas tu duduk, bawa sampai ke atas.
Dulu masa ada payung terjun buat show nak terjun sini, jatuh dengan jalan dekat runabout.
Oh ada?
Ada dulu.
Ini cerita yang saya dah dengar sebab kita tak sempat hidup zaman tu. Actually part
dia bila nak buat pertunjukan apa-apa, dia nak turun tujuh payung kat sini kan. Tapi hari tu tak tahu angin macam mana dia boleh jatuh kat
runabout. Kita tahu
dia
pecik.
Tahun berapa saya tak ingat. Tapi memang ni free fallnya jatuh tengah jalan.
Pasti
dia mati dia.
Nanti 1960s ke 70s?
Dekat bulatan, jatuh kat bulatan.
Bulatan ni kan dulu ada bulatan ni.
Bulatan besar,
bulatan
Edinburgh. Yes, bulatan Edinburgh, correct. But Edinburgh
sebelah Dewan Bahasa sana.
Dewan Bahasa. Dewan Bahasa sana.
Itu nama lama tu. Kalau you pasang dulu nama ni, Jalan Birch. Tahun 80-an dia tukar. Siapa musuh utama dia?
Mahathir.
Mahathir Razak.
Dia swap ke?
Ya. Dia swap aja kan? Ya.
Yeah. So that was the story. How they change the name of the nama British dia jadi nama Melayu kan? Nama Malaysia kan?
Encik Lai tahu apa?
Siapa?
Encik Lai tahu apa?
Saya 84.
Sebaya dengan anak makcik.
Saya 52.
Saya muda.
Saya 52.
Tapi saya tak pandai buat ni.
Tapi Stadium Merdeka ni memang tempat kita orang.
Kau. Memang betul. Sebab ni saya nak tahu cerita Muhammad Ali ni. How many people know that Muhammad Ali used to have a boxing match here? They have one time Muhammad Ali was here.
Itu yang Dato' Arun lenggut kata tu.
Correct. Kau. Dato' Arun, tambah Dato' Arun.
Saya selalu tanya, taman tu Dr. Ismail. How many people know about tu Dr. Ismail? Siapa tahu tu Dr. Ismail?
Everyone just sit down here. Outside kat tengah. Sit saja. Just sit down here. Kakak, everyone. Everyone just sit down. Come.
Abang. Kau nasib baik dapat orang ramai bang.
Kalau berorang memang kena bang.
Tapi askar tak tapi askar.
Tentu kau mengangkat lagi.
Dulu dekat lekuk tu, kan ada punya tu kan? Itu Pak Dewi hari dulu.
Ah betul betul. Ha, dekat lekuk tu betul. Dia cukup lah. Ha, gombol.
Kamu boleh cari. 14 kan?
14 je orang tu. Ada dia Pak. You can. Sorry again.
Come, let's go, let's go.
People is apa neglect that story. Sebab dia rasa Malaysia was established 1997. No. Dia ada two parts of the story. That's why kita ada 1997. Hari Malaysia. So hari Malaysia tu. Bring up the capacity from 20,000 to 40,000. That was built, was constructed between 1980s for the Sukan Sea. Then also the electric scoreboard. Then after the conservation punya works, one of the element that was brought down was actually the electric scoreboard. So dia redo balik the tipe scoreboard as it is together with the emblem. So you notice the end? You nampak eh? Bintang kan? Bintang yang sama kat mana? Dekat Melaka, sebelah Dataran Pahlawan. Siapa-siapa pernah pergi kan Dataran Pahlawan punya shopping mall sekarang ni? There's one part ada place tu depan muzium, Muzium Rakyat. Ada satu tiga segi triangular monument, dia tulis M. That is M, example the same thing, Merdeka. Why, kenapa memorial peristiwa Merdeka berada di Melaka? Because the story of Merdeka was mentioned, confirmation by Tunggu di Melaka, Padang-Padang Gede in 1956. February 1956, after dia balik daripada London, successful negotiation dengan British. So waktu tu dah dapat tarikh. Tarikh dia 31 Ogos 1957. That is what the start of all the events towards being a free nation. And before that, the idea of the nation comes about, it was more than 10 years. In fact, more, if you go more detail, more than 20 years. More than 50 years actually. During the nationalism after World War I. Then World War I start of nationalism. Seluruh dunia ada ada mengeluarkan cerita nasionalisme di mana kuasa-kuasa kolonial telah dicuba dikurangkan. Banyak negara-negara nak minta kemerdekaan. Dan during the World War II was actually the pinnacle because Japan showcase to the whole world that we can stand by ourselves. That was the symbolic part of Japanese punya invasion. You put aside the other factor, we just take it from the positive side. It give us some sort of belief that we have the confidence to govern our own country. And then, if you notice as well, Malaysia punya independence is quite late compared to other countries yang dapat independence daripada Britain. Kita agak lambat, 10 tahun selepas World War II. Because World War II, kita surrender, Japan surrender is 1945, lebih pada 10 tahun. Tapi kita prepare ourselves to govern, self-govern. And towards the end, we have our first general election on 1955, where Persekutuan Tanah Melayu ditubuhkan secara rasmi
dan Tunku Abdul Rahman menjadi Chief Minister yang pertama of the Nation of Malaya. Ketika itu masih lagi di bawah the Crown of Britain, masih lagi di bawah Crown of Britain, not yet fully governed. Okay, but it gives kita terbitkan what we call as the precedent towards being able to self-govern. So during the early days, how many states actually is over there?
11
kan? Why is 11?
Singapore.
Why is it? What is the combination of the 11? Why is it? Pelikan siapa ke Johor?
Melayu.
Melayu tu siapa? Siapa Melayu? Why is it? Because remember, Melayu is a federation.
Singapore tak masuk.
Singapore was not. Why?
Sebab crown kan?
Yes. British decide. Sebab kalau tak dia duduk proses dia negeri-negeri Selat. Dia saja dipisahkan kerana kedudukannya. Fungsi dia tu sangat besar daripada British. Yes, correct. Yes. So dia berbeza sikit. Alright. So the idea of ini, how do you justify about the coat of arm of Malaya? Malaysia can be defined based on the coat of Malaya alone. The emblem tu dia talk about the whole history of Malaya. Apa itu keris kelima?
Lima negeri yang bersultan.
Bersekutu.
Lima negeri bersekutu.
Ya ke?
Lima.
Negeri bersekutu ke? Lima negeri bersekutu ke? Negeri pegaja ke?
Habis tak? Empat negeri bersekutu.
How many can tell me the story about it? Ini 1957 kan? Sebab panas kan? Negeri Melayu bersekutu, negeri Melayu tidak bersekutu adalah yang keris berlima. Negeri Melayu tidak bersekutu, unfederated Malay state. Negeri Melayu tidak bersekutu di mana negeri
Johor.
Yang cuti hari Jumaat pertama Pelik, Kedah, Kelantan, Enu, Johor. Negeri-negeri yang bersepadan dengan negara. Senang. Yang empat yang tengah tu stand for what? Apa bendera apa yang pakai color tu?
Bukan lah, bersekutu lah tu.
Tak, itu Selangor.
Apa? Okey, belah kanan tu siapa? Belah kanan siapa?
Melaka.
Belah kanan?
Pinang.
Belah kanan, yang belah kiri. Belah kiri you all lah.
Pinang.
Right? On your right hand side apa?
Melaka.
Okey, yang tengah tu resemble siapa?
Negeri bersekutu.
Terengganu ke? Terengganu duduk, bawa keris. Nampaknya dah betul tahun-tahun kita merdeka ni. Ramai orang tak faham apa pasal kita. Okay, first and foremost, saya tanya, siapa orang Perak? Siapa orang Perak?
Separuh.
Mak orang Perak.
Putih.
Mak orang Perak.
Siapa orang Perak?
Mak
orang Perak. Okay, pilih nama dia, step dulu apa? Nombor abjad nombor B pergi mana pula?
Pinang.
Tak, kalau abjad A, plate number A dekat Perak. Kalau plate number B kat mana pula?
Selangor. Selangor B.
Apa kaitan Selangor dengan Perak?
Sepadan.
Abjad C pergi mana?
Sahang.
Apa kaitan dua orang tiga tu?
A, B, C.
Negeri Melayu bersekutu.
Bersekutu lah.
Dia sama dengan Kelantan D lah.
Tapi ni Kelantan.
Oh, Melayu
bersekutu. So, negeri Selangor kata, aku tak payah pilih lah. Di bagi ke Kelantan. That was part of the story lah. Okay. Empat yang colour yang you nampak ni adalah colour bendera kepada semua empat negeri tu. Merah, kuning, putih, kuning, hitam. Untuk Perak, negeri sembilan ada merah. Okay. Pahang, hitam, putih. Betul?
Betul.
So, it resemble that one. Dan diorang bercuti pada hari Ahad. Sebab dia ada resident British. Sebab resident British nak pergi church. Itu dia cerita dia. Governance system is because of that. That's how we ada perbezaan. Kenapa ada orang cuti hari Jumaat, ada orang cuti hari Ahad.
Sekolah pun tak ajar.
Dia tak ajar. Orang tanya mak saya selalu tanya mak saya, kenapa saya cuti hari Jumaat? Saya senang pergi semain Jumaat. Itulah kan, waktu ketika tu kan. For some people. But because that was part of our history. It was agreed upon that. That was the story that is very unique. But you notice, Melaka dengan Penang. Kalau you notice sekarang, dia ada beza tau. Dia punya korang faham. Apa beza dia? Kijang bukan Kijang, bukan Melaka. Apa dia Kijang? Kijang apa?
Kijang tu Kelantan.
Kijang ni. Kelantan. Kelantan kenapa Kelantan pilih hijab? Tuan pintik. Dia buat bisnes. Apa logo band negara?
Kijang.
Cik Siti Wang Kembar ni pakai kijang. Pasal kijang ni very unique. Ah, dia kaki bisnes. Sebab dikatakan kijang ni dia boleh smell. Dia smell of gold. Itu cerita dia lah. Tapi ada beli kijang dia sebenarnya. Ada satu lagi dia punya terapkan yang paling nak beli. Takkan kijang tu pasal apa? Yang kena consider balik. Dia adalah makanan favorite kepada harimau. Kalau you jumpa kijang, dia very likely within 20 km radius. Dia ada buku dia, tapi ini saya tak ingat. Benar saya tak ingat. Tapi yang ni gambing dengan lari hitam tu. Okey, dia tu sedang jadi untuk yang bawah. Itu yang pertambalan silver tu bagi dia dah aku kita jumpa. Dia letak elemen dalam dia punya muskat tu dipakai buat gambing, elemen gambing dengan lari hitam. So dia ada berbeza-beza. So every state have their own coat of arm based on the animal and also the natural part. Tu dia tanaman lah. Okay, so that is called sorry. Tapi macam mana dia pakai jenis tu tadi? Macam mana you nak relate balik dengan Michael Jackson? How can people can relate? Yang saya tanya tu, apa kaitan dia dengan Michael Jackson?
Harimau
ni nama saintifik dia apa? Siapa tahu dia?
Pantera
Tigris. Pantera Tigris. Lagi? Pantera Tigris Jackson ni. So, masa Michael Jackson datang, dia terkejut lah nampak adik-beradik dia. Oh, ada dua ekor. That was the missing family he was talking about. The long lost forgotten cousin. Rupanya harimau Melaya je. But do you know, Pantera Tigris Jackson ni tak pernah pun menjejak kaki di bumi Borneo. Is anyone aware tak?
Tak tahu.
Di Borneo tak ada harimau. Dia tak ada kalimau. Dia cuma ada ujang senang. Buaya dia cuma tak. Dia tak ada kalimau. Sewaktu zaman ais, dia terpisah. So, dia bila binatang tu terpisah, yang kalimau banyak lari ke Penang sebab dia cukup makanan. Yang duduk di dalam pulau, dia mati. Dia tak boleh sembah. So, you see, kalau you baca The Malay Archipelago by Russell Wallace, dia menceritakan the imagery line of Wallace line. Yang memisahkan the big mammal dengan the small mammal. The big mammal, the big birds, macam burung emu, kangaroo, ni banyak duduk dekat Australia punya plate. So, diorang kat sana tak ada carnivore. That's why they have a problem. They have a problem to sustain the kangaroo. Sebab dia tak ada natural predator.
Tak ada. Ekosistem.
Ekosistem dia terbatas. That's why the elephant in Borneo, kita panggil dia pygmy elephant. It's not the same as the elephant dekat belum yang you nampak. So, it's very different.
Dia lebih kecil.
Lebih kecil. Pasal apa? Sebab dia punya area tu small for them to find the food. So, the natural evolution by Charles Darwin, dia
kecil, dia adapt
by themselves. So then they can sustain. Remember the iguana in Galapagos?
Yeah.
They are able to swim because of they want to adapt to the existing surrounding so that they can able to sustain. Right? Pantera Tigris Jackson ni. Adik-beradik kepada Michael Jackson yang lima. Alright, let's go. Baik, mana Kim?
Kita turun.
Itulah. Okey tak?
Cuma nanti somebody has to ni lah, be careful. Pegang lah.
Mesti ada boleh-boleh step kat kilo. Kan ni? Kalau tak boleh.
Can you help?
Thank you. event kita terpaksa alter sikit itinerary hari ni. So sepatutnya kita habis kat atas dengan kat bawah. I think Uncle semua minggu lepas dia sempat lah. Tapi because ada banyak event, ni memang banyak event lah. So that is ni. So anyway, thank you for spending a little bit more than 60 minutes. Dia ada masa tambahan pula. Luckily semua tak ada ni kan, tak ada tangan dia. But the thing is, we are very fortunate to be able to still be standing on this particular ground. If you're talking about 20 years back, I think the nature of this building already collapsed lah. Already been demolished lah. As simple as that lah. Bila orang tanya, kenapa nak demolish? Prime land.
It's a prime land issue. When you talk about prime land, harga tanah sangat tinggi lah. So, you cannot run away from the fact that money plays a big factor in any development. That is one of the reasons why heritage is so popular in this area of the country. Why? Because heritage is always seen as something which is a hindrance. Dia selalu menyusahkan orang, menyebabkan orang terpaksa bayar keluar duit lebih. Tetapi heritage is not about that. The heritage is about human being ability to understand the emotional part of us. Kalau you tak jumpa, kenapa you makan nasi goreng? Kenapa you makan ketupat? Nasi goreng you boleh makan hari-hari, ketupat you makan setahun sekali je. Kalau makan hari dia tak jadi. Kenapa rendang you makan setahun sekali? I give you example lah. Hari raya, you balik kampung, confirm jam kan? Kenapa balik raya? Kenapa balik raya? You dah tahu balik kampung berjam-jam, berpuluh jam, habis duit. Duduk hari raya sekejap ke? Tak sampai 10 jam ke? Lepas tu balik. Why? Kenapa kita belajar kat overseas, kita nak balik kampung? Why? Because human being always longing for comfort, home. Beza antara house and home. There's no way like home. Visit of course, Yes, correct. Means that, dalam erti kata lain, dalam konteks sebagai seorang manusia, kita tak dapat lari. Itu adalah sifat manusia. It's our natural feeling to go back home. Kita tak panggil balik rumah. Kita tak payah kata rumah tu ada connotation lain. Di dalam konteks bahasa Melayu, kita panggil mungkin rumah berbeza. Kita panggil connotation dia kampung. Kita balik kampung. And kampung give you a spirit in your heart and your mind. And somehow it relates back to your family members, the one that is close by to yourself. So that is what the devil wants. When sing see the breaker, you are able to lead back. Selamat datang tuan-tuan dan puan-puan. Anda tiba di lapangan terbang antarabangsa Kuala Lumpur. Kepada rakyat Malaysia, selamat datang. And by that statement alone, we feel so warm. Dan kehangatan itu yang menyebabkan kita keep on asking for that. We keep on asking for that. The comfort part. Comfort food because of rasa selesa tu. Sebab walaupun rumah kita tak sehebat mana, tak sebesar mana, tak sejauh mana, tetapi keselesaan tu, kehangatan yang dihasilkan daripada kasih sayang kepada rumah itu yang menjadikan dia menjadi home. And we want Malaysia to be home to all of you, regardless of who we are, age group, religion, race, whatever. When we say Malaysia is our home, everybody is welcome. So saya hari ini saya punya dua hari ini kata mula tu. Tadi saya nak pakai ayat tu, saya terpisah dulu. Tuai padi antara masak. Jangan sampai layu-layuan. Intai kami antara nampak. Jangan sampai rindu-rinduan. So mean that, kalau ni first time you datang, hopefully you will come again. Jangan sampai rindu baru dah datang. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. I give you apa ni, I really appreciate your time. Thank you very much. Siapa-siapa nak ambil cempur belakang, kita ambil cempur kat depan. Ambil stand.